The NBA restart is just a week away. Now, for a refresher, let's get to know the frontrunners and the best players in the league this season. We're joined by Barangay Ginebra Gin Kings Head of Analytics, Patrick Partosa, to break down the numbers. Hello, Patch. Thank you so much for joining us here in ANC. All right, so Patch, let's get right away to the bottom of the things. Who are your top five? Let's start with the first.
My number one pick for MVP right now has to be Giannis Antetokounmpo. The Bucks have the best record in the NBA, and they have the best net rating by far, which is the difference between their offense and their defense. So if you were to compare that, they're number one, and that actually the top three players in plus-minus, which means that when they step on the floor, at the end of the day, after all the minutes, all the games that have been played, they have the highest point differential. So they're always plus in that category. Giannis, Eric Bledsoe, and Chris Middleton are top three. And Giannis, of course, leads all of them. He's averaging 30 points a game, 14 rebounds, and 6 assists. And beyond, first of all, those are numbers that Shaq likes to call that every single dominant big man needs to have. Like, he's getting them all and then some. So for a guy who's actually playing more of a wing or some, you know, the point guard position, he's handling the ball a lot. They're having a dominant season. And in fact, before he got injured, there was talk that they could get the 70 wins. I think any team that could, you know, get the 70 wins or close to that, they probably have a dominant player. And that guy for them is Giannis Antetokounmpo.
And they're now at 53-12, the first in the East. Now, besides the stats that you mentioned, he's also averaging close to 55% in field goal percentage. What have you seen in terms of improvement, in terms of offense for Giannis?
I think he's completely built on what he's done last year. Last year, he was the MVP. So this year, he's actually improved in some areas. The reason they fell to the Raptors in 6 games in last year's Eastern Conference Finals was he didn't figure out really how different teams would adjust to him, because every team now knows that he's the guy. You know, he's the guy that every team is going to have to stop if they want to have a chance of beating the Bucks. So this year he's ready for it. He's ready for all the different defenses they can throw, the junk defenses. If they try to pack the lane, he's finding shooters better. He's not forcing things, and he's vastly improved in his jump shot. If I could pull these numbers out this year, he's only at 31% from three, which you might think isn't really good at all. But considering he shot 26 last year, 26%, he's increasing. So that little improvement is enough for defenses to start thinking, maybe if it hits one or two, I might have to go out there and chase him and, you know, put a hand up. Last year, you think every time he puts it up, you're thinking, okay, that's a good shot for us.
Yeah, you're right, Patch. Actually, that was the point that I was trying to extract out, because this year, he's been vocal on improving his jump shot, extending his range a bit. And you're right, when he takes a three, sometimes you just really have to close out, and there's a higher chance of it going in. That's why his field goal percentage went up this year. Also, next on your list is LeBron James, Patch.
LeBron James, whenever a guy hits 30, you already think that he's on the way down. But right now, LeBron's producing at still an all-time rate. I think we've given a lot of credit to Russell Westbrook the past couple of years because he's averaged a triple-double. But right now, LeBron's pretty close. If you look at his numbers, he's got 26 points a game, which is good for 13th in the league. He's got 8 rebounds, so only one or two off from getting to that 10, that magic number. And he also averages 11 assists, or 10.6, which is number one in the NBA. He's never done it before in his career. Now he's leading the league in assists. So this is a crazy development. And you'd think he's already stopped improving and stopped trying to change his game. In my opinion, he's only getting better, because all the things that he took for granted before, the ability to just at any time, you know, cross someone up and or just power through everybody, now he's learned the game slowed down so much for him. Now, he realizes he doesn't have to do that all the time. He can sort of take it easy, take it slow. And the Lakers are the number one team in the West. Last year, they didn't even make the playoffs. I know they added Anthony Davis, they added Rajon Rondo, and like a bunch of supporting pieces. But a team with Anthony Davis never even made the playoffs for most of his career in New Orleans. And now they're both averaging 26 points a game, and LeBron's completely... I think the comparison before when he entered the league was of Magic Johnson. And now he's beginning to play more like that, more than the closest comparison in recent years was to be a Michael Jordan kind of dominant scorer. Now he's kind of doing everything, like, across the board. And at age 35.
It's amazing how you mentioned the age 35, usually in the world of sports, when you talk about athletes who are there, who are still competing at a high level, whether if it's a Tom Brady, whether if it's a Roger Federer, but now we have LeBron James. Turning 36, still in the race for the MVP, but you mentioned 10.6 assists per game. Usually, the players who average at this number are point guards. But LeBron is a 1-5 guy. But how do you think he's able to do this, dishing out 10 assists per game?
I think a lot of credit also has to go to the Lakers coaching staff. Because last year and maybe early last year and the Cleveland years, he probably didn't have a system that would make him make full use of his ability to pass the ball. Now everything's dialed in. Everybody knows the roles, and everybody just does what everybody does what they're supposed to. JaVale McGee knows what he's got to do. He's got to roll hard to the rim. He's got to affect them defensively. Then you also have guys like Avery Bradley before the coronavirus hit. He knows his role. He's not going to handle the ball too much. He's not going to be the guy who's going to dribble up, bring the ball up the floor, and start dishing out assists. Now everything revolves around LeBron and that high-low game and that game, that inside-out game between him and Anthony Davis. And that's really the bread and butter. I think I saw something the other day where it said that LeBron James actually gives more fast break points to Anthony Davis than the other way around. You'd think usually the combination is the big outlet pass to a small, but now it's sort of reversed. Now LeBron brings the ball down and he's finding Anthony Davis for those easy baskets early in the offense. So they make life easier for one another in a lot of ways.
Pat, who's next on your list?
Next on my list would be let me go with James Harden first. I actually had him in the wrong order. James Harden, leading scorer in the NBA, joined with his Oklahoma City buddy Russell Westbrook. You'd think that a guy who averages 34 points a game is going to win MVP every time. And Harden has his detractors, for sure. He dribbles a lot. He takes a lot of bad shots. He holds the ball for much of the possession. Everybody on his team just sort of watches him when he goes into that ISO mode. But you can't deny the results. I mean, in the tough Western Conference, the Rockets are consistently in the top four seeds and over the past few years. And this year is no exception. They are they're number six, but they're tied with the fourth, fifth, and they're always right there. Let's see. You'd think that when Russell Westbrook joined the team, you'd expect some of his numbers to go down, but they've only continued to go up. And since they traded Clint Capella, they've reinvented themselves, right? They're the first team to play completely small ball. They don't have anybody over 6'7" or 6'8".
Yep.
And they have PJ Tucker playing the center position. Now everything revolves around Harden. These playoffs are make or break for him, because they built this complete roster around him in a lot of different ways. And the way he's performed this season shows just how much of how the Rockets play around him. Like, everything revolves around him. If they won a couple of more close games here or there, he'd probably have a better case. But I think for right now, he's number three.
As much as we see the highlights, averaging 34 a game, all the step backs, all the isolation plays, but he's very underrated in terms of his passing games, actually averaging 7.5, close to 7.5 assists per game. So also, maybe a similar question to LeBron on how he's averaging 10.6 a game. What do you think is a factor to James Harden's playmaking abilities? To which do we give credit to?
My answer would be similar to the one for LeBron. It's the system around them. Because the way the Rockets play, they play five out now. Or even at the start of the year, they only had one big on the floor. It's Capella. Now they play five out. So the floor is completely spread for Harden to do his thing. If he does an isolation and somebody helps, that's a kickout pass. Somebody's open. And the other four guys on the floor are always shooters. They might not be the best shooters. They're not going to be all Kyle Korvers or Klay Thompsons. But they're guys who can knock down the shot. You have, who do you have around him? You got PJ Tucker, you got Robert Covington, you got Westbrook, whose numbers are climbing back steadily. And usually you have another guy like Ben McLemore or somebody off the bench. Anybody of those guys are adequate or good shooters. So if you break someone down, nobody helps, he gets this bucket. Or he steps back and hits a three. If you send somebody to help, one of those guys is going to be open. And that's where he gets majority of his assists. Off the pick and roll or pick and pop. Or if he dives and you collapse, he kicks it out. So those were you getting assists and points, of course, in isolation.
Who's next for you, Patch?
Next on my list would be the young guy, Luka Doncic. He's all of 21 years old. And I know a lot of people compare Zion Williamson, or they say he's the next LeBron, or he's the next big thing. I think the future is now, especially this year. At age 21, I know that we know that Derrick Rose won the youngest MVP award ever. This year, if these other guys weren't having such extraordinary seasons, it could very well go to him. 29 points a game, 9.3 rebounds, and 8.7 assists. That's an all-time season. Considering that 2 years ago, this guy was in Europe. He was in the NBA. And now he's barely legal to drink in the United States of America. But he's pretty much taking apart the NBA on a nightly basis. The only knock I would have on him at this point is maybe he takes too many three-pointers. He's taking 9 a game, and he's only hitting about 32.9 of them, or 32%. But aside from that, he's top in most categories. The Mavericks have the number one offensive rating in the league, so they're number one. They're better than the Lakers, the Bucks, every single team out there. And that's mainly because of him. Like, he can create in any situation. He's the future. So maybe not this year, but in the following years for sure.
Lastly, Patch, who's your pick for MVP?
My pick for MVP would have to be Giannis. They have the best record in the league. They have the best defense. So I think they'll go farther than this year. And last year, they went to the conference finals. I think they're making the finals this year. And that's all because I don't think the NBA has an answer at this point for Giannis. Those numbers, he only plays about just over 30 minutes a game. So if he played more, they're blowing teams out. So if he played more minutes, his numbers would be even better. But he doesn't need to because they're winning so much. And for me, that's what tips it over for my MVP pick.
Just a week away before the NBA's restart, Patrick Cardoza, thank you so much for joining us here in ANC.